Hello everybody, my name is Marian Zburle and I'm really happy to be here and to discuss about it too, which I'm excited about. It's new, better, faster, so let's try to embrace it before it goes out, so we'll be ready for it when it happens.
Which is?
Come here?
Which is when it is
So let's see, it's about time.
are we talking weeks or months or what?
Yeah,
is there any idea?
Let me check again. So it will be ready, when it will be ready, and I'll be happy to.
Yeah, I told that to my client that he's not happy with that.
Yeah. Okay. So, my surprise, which is not a surprise, but of course, yeah. It's about an e-smart blog. That's how I started the idea, but actually now I'm thinking of smart site or something like that because it's not meant to be just a blog. So let's talk about it. Setting it up in two lines of code. This assumes that you already have an E2 app setup. So if you already have an E2 app setup, you just use compose the require and the path that will be publicly released by me whenever it is finished. And then you use the migrations to build the tables and you can already start using it. Done. That's it. But now let's assume that you don't have any to add stuff. So I'll walk you through the basic steps that I always use. Okay, so first, this is one time done, at least for me. You download Composer, then you move it to a global place. That's a tip down there. From time to time, you need to update the Composer so it doesn't throw errors or stuck in the process of downloading your stuff. So, download it one time, move it to a global place, and then just use Composer without any worries. You don't have to download for other projects. That's my suggestion anyway. Okay, then for myself, I prefer to use advanced setup than basic setup. For various reasons, I can talk about them later on. So let's create a project. Start it there for the moment, as we are still under development. E is still under development. And we create an advanced setup, and the path is blocked to advanced. And then we change into that path, whichever it is, and we use the init script. The init script will take care of creating params files, make config files, setting up something that really bugged me in E1, which is folder permissions. You have to set up folder permissions for assets and for protected runtime always, which when you're migrating from server to server, you always forget about it and then you wonder why things are not working. So this is done already from one line of code, which is init. Okay, then you configure Apache if you're using Apache, otherwise you configure your preferred web server. You point your, admin area and your user area to the specified path. I'm also using something that I wanted to bring up in Apache, the reason that I'm not still using Nginx, which is macros. So here is an example of a macro. I can happily give you the code if you can't find it over the web. So macros is defining one configuration or multiple configurations and then use it for n sites.
Make it bigger.
You got the same Nginx.
Exactly. Not really. It's copy paste in Nginx. It's online of code. After this, you just use the host macro, the name of your domain and the path of your domain, and that's it. Only one line of code. In Nginx,
you don't need one line of code in Nginx, it just runs like that.
Maybe. Show me that after you
can't see that.
Control plus.
But it's not just principle.
Control plus.
Yes.
That's too much.
Okay. So basically, the configuration is wrapped around the vhost macro, and then you just call it and it happens.
That's a front-end job.
Yeah. Okay, then if you don't have a database, you need to create one. usually use databases to store your data. Okay, this is pretty similar to E1, but it's in the to-do steps. Okay, I will have to mention but after the presentation, that the table prefix was just a bit different in E2 than in E1, which is you have to add percentage sign in between the square brackets in order to evaluate the table prefix, if you're using table prefixes. Otherwise, it's just okay, just like E1. Okay, now we get to the first part, which we assume that you already have an E2 app set up. So download the add-on and run the migrations to create the tables. This is optional. If you prefer to have friendly URLs, you need an htaccess file. This is a basic one, so it's just for the things to get started, which means if you find the file or the directory, render that one, otherwise send everything to index.php. Okay, edit the backend config, main PHP file, and target, tell E about the module, and in URL manager, use enable pretty URL. I love this. It's fun, yeah.
Control plus.
And show script name false. And yeah, control plus for you. Sorry. Okay. And also tell E about the path of the user, whether he needs to use it for actual logins and authentications and registration and so on. Okay.
So that component, that internationalization component that I mentioned on the other presentation, would be here as well.
Yeah. So what's left on the to-do list of my special project or surprise project? So I created the user module where you can log in, register, recover, resend, and reset pass everything related to the user, the basic ones, of course. I started working on the articles, I created the migrations, the database structure, and I'm working now on actually developing the module that interacts with the database. I also want to create a social panel, but a very simple one. Don't think that I'll implement like something like Facebook. It's just basic stuff about you, maybe a hobby and so on, so the user could get a feeling about you. And maybe change your password, change your email and so on. Messaging area, where you could receive users, messages from other users or alerts from the system, there's something new or something wrong and so on. And the dashboard, which tells you a bit about you, what have you done, like you've created, let's say, articles, that many users have been visited your profile, and whatever can be put in a maybe login homepage area. I want to keep them very simple, as user can then extend them, but the basic functionality should be there. And the one that I will spend more time on it, is the permissions module. The permissions module is similar to Drupal's one, if you ever use Drupal. It basically scans all modules, all add-ons, all controllers and so on, finds out about the actions, and builds you a list of them, so you can create operations, which basically translates to actions, tasks, which are groups of operations, or business roles, which are groups of tasks, or operation, or a combination of them, and so on, and roles like unauthenticated, authenticated, manager, on top of manager, on top of manager, and so on, admin and super admin. So play with those ones. Create unit tests for all of those while I develop them, and the documentation and how to build those, that's what's left. Pretty much I feel like I'm at the first a bit, so the bigger part were the user module and the permissions module, the rest of them are quite easy, and I'll also make them public for everyone to use, free and so on, once I finish. I'm trying to do them in a best practice way, very well commented, so not that many questions arise. and I'll keep you posted with whatever is happening. Yeah. I've also had some demos here, but since my laptop is not connected to the screen, I can happily show you basic logins and logouts and stuff like that, recover password if you really feel that you need to see them.
Yeah. What was the most different thing that you had to adapt into whilst coding from version 1?
Well, I had to get used to namespaces, get used to the idea. I didn't have to get used to the use because it's similar to Java or JavaScript or ActionScript. You have to use Flash, which tells you, well, import by functionality, import by functionality, and so on, so I can use it. The new way of improving the writing of PHP 5.4 plus code, like new arrays, new functions, traits, and so on, which is pretty cool. It's more memory efficient, greater speed, and whatever, but you still have to get used to it once you start using it. You don't just change over the eyes. So it's a lot of backspace and so on. Okay, I'll be happy to take questions after this.
This is more, front end, but.
Yeah, sure.
You created that in a way that, is it possible to create widgets? Or you plan to do it? For example, I use WordPress.
Yes.
So I know for people that use PHP to develop little box, like display the latest 5 blogs or blah, blah. If you want to do something like that, you'd be able to create modules for that.
I do intend to do that, but the way I intend to do it, it's actually what's in my head, actually. So I want to look at WordPress because it's shitty, but it's popular, so people like it. I want to look at WordPress and let's say up to maximum two more other ones that are taught there, and actually take the most used functionality there and try to reproduce it here. Let's say for some reason a calendar is something that needs to be in a website and almost every blog user has it. So I'll try to reproduce it here as a widget, but this is a main add-on, so those would be kind of like add-ons to this one.
Yeah, I asked that because, for instance, you created that version, and then I'm sure that if you want to keep updating that, people that was going to use your code, they don't want to really change the core.
No,
so they want to build more modular, otherwise when you update your core, that's going to affect if they make...
Also, when I build stuff and whenever guys build stuff, they tend to output whatever comes from the controller that integrated the model. Let's say some data comes, some data, some structure, and so on. Whatever is available for the view, we tend to put it in a comment on top of it. And then you know, well, I have from the model the title and the description, and I have from this other object, products maybe, and so on. So we have it already there in the header. We just need to play with it, attach some divs and styles.
Probably the same goes for templating, right? Because then but people are going to need to do something.
Yeah,
otherwise,
I know.
Everyone is going to have the same kind of...
So you get a basic template there, and then you extend from it. So the basic template doesn't really change. It only adds to it. The let's say, before functionality is still there. So whenever a major version will be there, unless it's really necessary, it's so great that you need to change, you'll have all the old stuff there, and you'll have on top of that new functionality. So it don't affect your job and your work and whatever.
You were mentioning about the advanced application templates. What can you tell us about it?
Well, the advanced one creates a separation which I like. So you manage your stuff here, and let's say for managing your stuff, you have backbone and AngularJS. Whatever, many fancy fireworks, but you don't really need some of that or most of that, depending on the project, in the front end. So you deal with your stuff in the back end. Maybe you want to have an HTTP access that you don't want to, with a password on top of it, but you don't want to worry when it goes live that no user can view your website because they don't have a password. It happened. So you just separate everything that you need. The databases, SQL, NoSQL, separate them in the backend, you have a common area role where you can share things between the backend and the front end, and the front end stays like pure and clean and so on, and offers the best performance for the user. So that's why I want it to be like that. I also, this is not like a secret and so on, that's the way I want to build my website, although it will not be present in this one. So I will use MySQL as a first database, then I will use also two other databases, Redis and Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch I will use only for searching, so whenever you type something and want to find something about the project, some articles and so on, it will go to Elasticsearch, as it's very fast to search. Return the results back, cache them anyway, do something about them, but that's how it is going to be. You never interrogate it MySQL. And Redis will be for actually grabbing, once you get the articles, you have also some IDs, right? So Redis is very fast to grab data based on an ID. It's not that fast as for searching as Elasticsearch is. It doesn't have that power of playing with the data and so on, but it's very fast at retrieving just one type of object and so on. So that's the way I find it. Mm-hmm. Use MySQL as old way, old fashioned way, as I can't really quit it right now. And then use Elasticsearch for search and use Redis for grabbing data and displaying on the users.
Any specific reason for using Elasticsearch?
It's easy to install.
Because I used it in a project. The thing is, in MySQL, everything is relationship. There are relationship between objects. It means that it maybe locks the database and unlock it, so it stops. I would say it stops the thing. Even if you select, it's a long query to get maybe just the article. Elasticsearch is done to only search, and it can be keywords everywhere, and it's really quick for it. And the same way Redis, the big advantage you can store any kind of data. There's no relationship, because the thing is today we use too much MySQL because we are used to it. But if you think about it, it's only, for example, if you want to book a plane for free seat in a plane, yes, you need a relationship inside. But if you want just to search in keywords like in Google or to search your data, Elasticsearch will be far more better for it. And even for to store, if you want to store a LinkedIn, which is optional for one specific user, it's better to store it not in MySQL because you will have a lot of empty tables, but in a key value oriented way.
I'll complete you. Yeah. If you didn't gather whatever he said, I did get it. I love it. I love NoSQL databases. But I can't really quit the SQL database, it has to be a transition.
So is that a reason why not?
So, because there is a transition, there's always a transition. You don't just step over and done. You forgot about it. Even if you know PHP and for some reason you think Python is better, you still have to start learning it, to get the best practices and so on. So that's exactly here what happens. Mm-hmm. Also, for my tests, I got up to 50 to 100 times faster responses in A/B testing from using Solr or Elasticsearch. Solr and Elasticsearch are kind of brothers, just different colors. Mm-hmm. But Elasticsearch is kind of the new kid on the block, so I wouldn't say Elasticsearch is better than Solr. It's just easier to install, easier to manage, while Solr does the same thing. But it's older, so it has a better community, but it's harder to set up. It always has something to do, some change that will, it takes time and so on. So I just like to try the new editor.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that was about it.
Redis, why Redis? Why not Memcache?
Come again?
Why Redis? Why not Memcache? I mean, you're just storing a key value pair, isn't it? So.
Yeah, well, from Redis and Memcache is kind of a choice, like a flip of coin. They have pros and cons, but they are kind of in the same. So it's not like I don't want to use Memcache. I use Memcache a lot.
Memcache is kind of natively supported in EE, and Redis is kind of an extension, is it?
The one con that Memcache doesn't really has is Redis also stores data.
The array.
From time to time, so you can configure it based on different parameters to store lesser or often and so on. which affects on other performance, but main cache doesn't. As far as I know, anyway. So it has has a semi-persistence. Mm-hmm. From time to time, you can have some snapshots of your database and revert to it if something goes wrong, in case something goes wrong. Yeah.
Okay, my question is basic. Is how do you feel, because I suppose you use Yi in 1.1 and 2.0. How do you feel about it when you develop? Is it quicker? Do you think that you can incorporate modules quicker, or it's
Well, right now it's not. Right now it's not quicker, definitely, because I still have to debug errors that are my mistake anyway, because I'm not used to it.
Yeah.
But then I need to find about a function, a class, a method. I usually go EAP based URL, request based URL. Now it no longer works. It's like host info. So it's about there. But once you get used to it, like you make the transition,
yeah,
it's a lot faster. When you define things, they look clearer. Even when you look at them, it makes more sense to use it.
Okay.
So I definitely think it's an improvement. How much it remains for you to tell, it remains for each of us, premium projects and style coding and so on, but definitely it's an improvement. For sure you can write codes faster, the same codes, the same functionality faster.
And do you try hybrid projects?
Come again?
Hybrid, I mean between 1.0, because when you have a big project already in 1.
Yeah, but that's what I'm doing at the current project, big project that I'm working on. So everything that's stable stayed on E1, because the business wants the word stable to be present in my sentence. And I started playing with E2 on improving the database and the, let's say, product manager, which is very, very slow, not because of E, because of the other circumstances. But anyway, I started using E2 and we're very happy about it for the moment, but it's not final. So until it's final, I'll still be playing with it. Yeah.
How much confident are you in terms of stability of the frameworks anyway?
So far? Well, I don't know.
Have you found stuff that you say, well, this isn't going live, you wouldn't put it live or stuff like that?
No.
You didn't fail to and you was missing bits of stuff.
At the moment, I've played with multi-project, something like just for testing or some advanced, like valid or chill live and so on, with E2. But at the moment that I, let's say, got the project done and I said, well, I'll go live with it, I couldn't say I had to do a workaround to make something work.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay.
So even if things change later, that my product will do.
It's only the third. Yeah, exactly.
Well, I have an example. There is an exist validation, which at first it started with a class name. So you specify the class, and based on the parameter, let's say it's an email, it will look for the same parameter in that class if it's an email. And now it's no longer defined by class name, it's defined by target class and target parameter. So you could compare email here with user email here.
Yeah.
So it's a small change, but it bugged me for an hour. So okay. You would encounter things like this. If there are changes, I think there will be more or less something like that. Mm-hmm. No major change, won't lose anything. It's just the way it is.
Okay.
How's the documentation for 2?
I have no documentation.
I've been going through the documentation, I've been contributing to the documentation.
I have a rule,
and it's as good as version 1, if not better.
I have a rule in my head. I have to dig in, find about stuff, actually write it in order to remember it. If I just read about it and don't do anything about it, I'll forget it the next day.
Right. I'm glad I'm not anyone.
So in terms of actual documentation that exists now, from what I've seen, I think it's on probably 90-something% complete. So if you get to the end of some documents there on documentation, especially on Git, on GitHub, you'll see that there are some that are TBD still, right? But people are contributing, people are making it work. There are some interesting parts of documentation that deal with creating applications on advanced template and basic template. So for someone starting out, there's a lot of material to be digested at the right time before you start to use
it. Halfway through learning E1, and I don't really want to bother learning it
if by the time we finish learning it, 2's out, I might as well switch straight to 2.
My opinion, and this is my opinion, it's not that it's something certain or that. It's more or less just a cosmetic. So it kind of does the same thing, just in a better way, and it's no longer red, it's reddish. So
right.
Maybe you put a colon here, maybe you put a backslash here, but once you get over it, it's kind of the same thing. It's just
an improvement.
I would stick to learning 1.1.4 for now, but be mindful of these changes, right? Because whenever you're ready, then whenever 2.0 is stable enough, you have to port your application. So if you remember some of the things that we spoke here, some of the things that Marian touched on here, it will be easier for you to port your application in the future.
Don't I have a place that shows just the difference or the change? So
the thing that will be.
This is precisely what I was going through here tonight.
Yeah.
So just the changes. So this document is not finalized. So we're going to go through the additional changes, the second part of the changes in the next month. But there will be a document which is meant to help you upgrade your 1.1 applications into 2.
Yeah. Also, kind of a side note, you're familiar with, if you ever installed a module in E1, you know, but basically it's like a copy of E is just inside of E. It cannot function by itself. It can function only in E, but it has the same structure. It has the views, the controller, the components, and so on, the config. So basically, the OSATons are just like modules which sat before in E's modules folder, only they are sitting now in Flanders folder. They are like a global module, so both of them have the same structure. It's just, let's say, normal modules will sit inside E, and global modules which can be used for any kind of app, let's say, sending emails or sending emails to the app. So it's not like my project sends emails, nobody else's project sends emails. So it's with a global, let's say.
So it's like imposing a complete application within your application.
Exactly.
In a certain way.
So whenever I mention this public, but there are already modules there, if you can want to get used to them, when I make this public, you'll just feel like it's E1 with a different path and 12 different names there because it's using SPSS and so on. But you'll get the feeling how it's built, you'll get the feeling how you want to build your own if you want, or how to extend it. And how easy it is to do things now. In terms of time, it's faster. So think about spending 3 hours developing something, 1 hour installing some modules, 1 hour customizing some views, actually think about connecting to the right database and make sure that everything is right, 3 hours of time. Maybe now it's taking only 1 hour. That's my opinion. After you get used to it, it's a lot faster. It makes more sense. That's my feeling about it. I don't want to brag about E2. It's not my child, but I love it.
Okay.
All right, so thank you very much.